So hello everyone. Let me start by thanking the organizers for setting up this new meeting format in these times. And it's not just a regular meeting, it's much more with interaction possibilities on Slack and whatnot. So for me at least, this has been kind of an eye-opening experience in terms of new ways we can communicate as a scientific community, communicate scientifically. So I think this is great. So let me start sharing the screen. And I will start my PowerPoint presentation. I changed the title a little bit. As you can see, it's a longer title now. And before I start, I'd also like to say that I put more text on these slides than I normally do, because I was a little bit thinking about the format, that maybe it was nice to have more stuff to read. And you'll also be able to go back and have a look on the slides using YouTube and other things. So the title is Multi-electron polarization and non-dipole effects in strong field ionization. And the motivation for this talk and for the work that I present is listed here. And it's very much related to some of the things we've already heard in the previous talks, namely that we face a number of fundamental and computational challenges. For example, we actually have difficulties dealing with more than two electrons if we want to try to pursue any problem using ab initio techniques. So what to do if we have more than two electrons? And in addition, there are a number of approximations that enter our fundamental description between the in the laser matter interaction, such as the electric dipole, for example, which we tend to do, but we are not always sure that this is okay. So these kind of thoughts led me to the following two questions, namely, how to deal with the time-dependent non-perturbative driving of a multi-electron system, and how to deal with situation where the nature of the external laser pulses leads to a breakdown of a conventional approximation like the electric dipole approximation. And in this talk, I'll address certain aspects of these two points. Let's see. So, specifically, I will give a status on the formulation and numerical implementation of a tunneling theory for large molecules with many electrons. And after that, I'll show how multi-electron polarization effects may lead to a simplification of the response of a many-electron system, which in fact can lead to an accurate formulation of a single active electron model. And in the end, I'll show how to include in an approximate but accurate manner non-dipole effects in strong field ionization and strong field light matter interaction scenarios. So this is three topics, and topic one is tunneling theory as promised, and I list here in this slide the papers on which this part of the talk is based, and you can look up those references and also other relevant papers there. So if the time scale of the variation of the external field is sufficiently low, we are led to this tunneling picture shown in this view graph, where the external fields distorts the atomic or molecular potential and the bound state can leak out. And now if we have this situation, we then study this for a fixed field strength. So this is a tunneling problem. So now I simply assume that this assumption of adiabatic approach is fulfilled, and we focus on that one. As you see here from the figure, traditionally what we have done is that we have looked at this problem by doing some matching out here in this asymptotic region. So most tunneling theories are formulated in the so-called, what I would call, tail representation, where you are occupied by the behavior of the tail of the bound state wave function matching to an outgoing wave. And this was also the way we formulated the original theory here, the weak field asymptotic theory, which was describing the situation of tunneling ionization from polar molecules. And I collected some formulas here on this slide. What you have here is basically the things that one needs to calculate for determining the tunneling rate of any molecule. And up here on the top, you have the ionization rate with some so-called parabolic quantum numbers reflecting that the problem of Coulomb potential plus external static field separates in parabolic coordinates. And the rate includes a structure factor and a field factor. And the field factor is the one that you find in most works on tunneling, namely this exponential one, which has a characteristic dependence on the binding energy E0 and the field strength F. And then there's some free factors here also reflecting the parabolic quantum numbers. And then whereas this is pretty standard for any system, and it doesn't reflect much properties of the system except the binding energy, this structure factor is more interesting because it includes information about the dipole of the ionizing orbital, and it also includes this thing which we call the asymptotic coefficient, which has information about the ionizing orbital in some large eta limit, meaning at large distances. So here you have something which is a property of the ionizing orbital, and therefore this is a system-specific property. And this is the somehow the difficult thing to calculate, because you need information about the orbital at large distances. So, and there's a problem with this, because if you want to go to large systems, large molecules, eventually you will have to go to kind of standard quantum chemistry methods or quantum chemistry software. And they're all, at least the typical approaches are based on expanding the orbitals in Gaussian type orbitals, which fall off too quickly to have a good representation of the tail. So, this is a problem, and therefore it would be advantageous if we could evaluate tunneling theory in a different way, namely in a way that relied on description of the wave function closer to the nucleus, where the Gaussian type orbitals have weight and where the representation of the wave function is accurate. And it is indeed possible to formulate tunneling theory in this manner using an integral representation. So this is what is discussed in this slide. And as I say, it's possible to obtain the tunneling rate from an integral, meaning a matrix element. And if you think on what we know from scattering theory, this may seem natural, since we know from scattering theory that scattering information can be obtained both from kind of a tail property through phase shifts, or alternatively from the T-matrix element, which is the integral approach. Anyways, we can obtain this asymptotic coefficient in terms of an integral written symbolically here, and these functions are confluent hybrid geometric functions and a core potential. And the point is that now this type of approach picks, of course, contributions up to the integral where these Gaussian type orbitals representing the ionizing orbital have weight. And you can find the formulation in the papers listed here. So there's a new way of formulating tunneling. Instead of looking at the asymptotic form of the wave function, you can look at this integral formulation. And this one we have implemented. And it's possible to go to very big systems. And for someone like me who started out in atomic physics, biphenyl is a big system. And here's an example illustrating what we can do. So in this particular case, we have the field pointing in the positive Z direction, and we have biphenyl, which consists of two benzene rings. And what we calculated here was the ionization rates, these gammas, as function of the angle between the two benzene planes. This is called the dihedral angle. And we can also calculate the structure factor, which is needed. And the conclusion is that the structure factor can now be evaluated with this integral formulation. And this allows a determination of the tunneling ionization rate for any system where the wave function can be determined by quantum chemistry methods. And this is important because tunneling is still used as an initial key step in much of strong field physics. So this concludes the first part of the talk and leads me to the second one, namely on multi-electron polarization. And some aspects of this multi-electron polarization were already alluded to in Robert's talk when he discussed the modeling of the argon and krypton experiments, namely this with the polarization. And this is what we will discuss now. So as I see it, in strong field single ionization of a many electron system, multi-electron polarization has two dominant effects. First of all, we have, if we look at the effective potential of an outgoing electron, it will feel the interaction with the laser, it will feel the Coulomb potential, and it will then, to the next leading order, it will feel an induced dipole potential and a permanent dipole potential if the system has a permanent dipole. And this induced dipole potential here is expressed in terms of the polarizability and the field, and therefore this of course has something to do with the polarization of the system. The other effect, which is also very interesting and in fact helpful for us, surprisingly, is that there is a turning off effect of the laser-electron interaction at small distances. The way to understand this is as follows. The electric field associated with the polarization of the core electrons counteracts the external field and leads to a cancellation of the laser-electron interaction. And it's simply because there's a rearrangement of the core electrons until they feel no effective field. So a rearrangement that sets up a field at short distances inside the atomic or molecular system that has a direction opposite to the external field, but with the same magnitude. So these kind of considerations lead us to thinking about different types of potentials as indicated here in this view graph here to the left, where I have a field-free potential. This is the blue curve. I have an instantaneous distorted potential. this is the dashed red one. And then I have the crosses, which describe the field-induced potential where the we have the polarization effect included. So the effect of the field is switched off at small distances. And here at large distances, we have the induced dipole potential. And we then tried another one where we just said, well, maybe this switching off here at last at small distances is the most important. And then we just kill the polarization effect in the outer region. So these are the kind of potentials that we're led to. And we wanted to have a look how these different types of potential, single active electron potential, capturing multi-electron polarization effects perform in actual calculations and perform when compared with experimental data. And for that reason, we took our time-dependent Schrödinger equation solver, and in the so-called Lenzgates formulation, where the interaction with the external field can be expressed like this, E times R times cosine theta, or in terms of suitably normalized Legendre polynomials, we can easily include the type of potentials I just presented to you. So we have the same interaction as before, and we can include the multi-electron polarization beyond the cutoff radius like this. And below, we just have the screening effect. And we can also just include some scaling function here that turns off the interaction beyond the cutoff radius. So these are the models that we are going to use and look at. And as an example of the behavior of this type of approach, we consider the orientation-dependent ionization from the highest occupied molecular orbital in the CO molecule. And this is now as function of orientation angle. And so on the x-axis, you have the angle between the CO axis and the dominant half cycle of the a two-cycle pulse at 800 nanometer and at an intensity of 8.8 times 10 to the 13 watts per square centimeter. And then you have the total yield on the y-axis. In the figure to the left, there's no polarization effect included, And in the figure to the right, there is polarization effects included. Okay, now it's interesting to note that the results to the right qualitatively agrees with the experimental results. And this agreement, together with the completely opposite trend when multi-electron polarization effects are not included, illustrates the importance of accounting for these multi-electron polarization effects. And we can also look at the model where we simply turn off the polarization potential beyond the cutoff radius, and that's the difference between the crosses and the circles. And for a system like CO, it's actually fairly accurate just to switch off the potential beyond the cutoff radius. The screening in the inner region is the main physical effect, it seems. We can also look at momentum distributions. In this case, you have the laser polarization in the Z direction here, and here you have frames showing the momentum distribution. And we see that these momentum distributions are not very sensitive to the polarization-induced dipole term as seen from the agreement between the results to the left, which include full multi-electron polarization, and the results to the right, which simply turn off the multi-electron polarization beyond the cutoff radius. And therefore, you could say that it seems that multi-electron polarization effects can be easily and accurately accounted for by the method described here. And it also seems that some types of observables are maybe not very sensitive to the exact form of the outer part of the laser-induced dipole term. The main physics seems to be captured by the screening at smaller distances. Very good. This brings me to the already to the last topic on non-dipole effects. And this part of the talk is based on recent work published this year, so you can have a look. I think this now, having listened to the other talks, I think this topic here is central. It's also related to one of the questions on magnetic effects in the adiabatic regime, because when we have more and more laser sources available at long wavelengths, we will have a relative higher effect of the magnetic component, of the Lorentz force component, and it could be that it's difficult to really consider the omega going to zero limit in laser matter interaction without taking into consideration non-dipole effects. So let's start. So traditionally, the dipole approximation is introduced, and in the dipole approximation, we approximate the spatial part of the electromagnetic field, written here, where KL is the wave vector of the propagating light and R is the position of the electron, by unity. Right? So naturally, this approximation assumes that the laser varies very little over the extent of the atom or molecule. Basically, this one here is assumed. So that's what we normally do. On the other hand, it has been known for many years, of course, that if this condition is no longer fulfilled, you will have a breakdown of the dipole approximation. We saw that many years ago if omega becomes big. So in somehow the opposite regime of what is relevant when you talk about tunneling, it has been known that the dipole approximation breaks down. And it has also been known that a typical signature of the breakdown is a lack of forward-backward symmetry with respect to the laser propagation direction. More recently, in strong field physics at mid-IR and IR wavelengths, breakdown of dipole approximation has been reported in a number of experiments, most recently in this nice Nature Physics paper. And this is part of the motivation of having a look here at this regime, I think. So, in simple terms, this breakdown in this regime at high intensity and low frequency occurs because the laser-induced velocity associated with the quiver motion scales as the field strength divided by omega. And of course, when omega becomes small and E becomes big, this can be a significant fraction of the speed of light, leading to the breakdown of the dipole. approximation. Now, in the conventional approach to non-dipole effects, you expand the laser matter interaction to first order and 1OC. But if you do that, you do not actually take advantage of the fact that the external field is strong. And this talk, I'll do that. I'll take advantage of this fact, and I'll introduce an accurate non-dipole strong field approximation Hamiltonian. This is what we call it. And I'll show that this Hamiltonian is accurate and free from certain defects that are present in the conventional 1OC expansion. And I'll then also show that this Hamiltonian is attractive for numerical analytical modeling. So this is really basic quantum mechanics stuff. We start with the minimal coupling Hamiltonian, where we have used the standard rule of substituting P by P minus QA when we have an external field described by the vector potential A in this case. And I take here eta as omega t minus omega xc, so the laser here propagates in the x direction. And I choose a polarization then, of course, in the yz plane. If epsilon is zero, it's linear polarized along the x direction. If epsilon is one, it's circular polarized in the yz plane. Then I expand the vector potential here to first order in C. It gives me the normal dipole term, and it gives me a correction term. The correction term, in fact, has two terms to it. It has something I call AC and AE, and these two terms are contributions from the variation of the carrier. This is this term which we normally consider, but there is of course also a contribution from the variation of the envelope. But if the pulse has a certain number of cycles, say seven or so, this contribution here from the envelope is already much, much smaller than the contribution from the carrier. So in this talk, we'll not be concerned with this latter contribution. Now, with all this, we have the Hamiltonian, which can be written like this, the conventional one, the external atomic and molecular potential, and two correction terms to first order and C, where A1 is the field up here. A problem with this Hamiltonian is that the term proportional to XPZ, so it's this one here, you see you have X up here and here you have P, so if you have linearly polarized along the Z direction, you'll have XPZ here. This one becomes, of course, non-negligible as X increases, and moreover, this product of operators complicates the practical numerical solution of the Schrödinger equation. So for example, we cannot use typical split step fast Fourier transform method. So it would be nice if we could introduce an accurate approximation that brings the Hamiltonian on a form which does not include products of X and PZ. And if we look at the Hamiltonian again here, we may already have an idea that if somehow A0 is sufficiently big, maybe this A0 times A1 is more dominant than this term. So this is the idea. Yes, and the idea is to find such an approximate accurate description first classically, and then after that construct the Hamiltonian. So we look at the classical equations of motion, where we have the Newton equations, including full retardation up here. We have the case where we include retardation to first order. So these are the this E01 and B1 are the fields expanded to first order and 1OC. And now these four lines here describe the scenario, the regime we're interested in, namely a regime where the laser intensity is large and the frequency is small. And therefore it makes sense to consider the effect of the B field component along the E field induced motion. So this is the approximation I want to introduce. So we have here the E field from the dipole part, and then we have here the not the full derivative of the position, but the derivative of the position, oh sorry, the velocity induced by the dipole part of the field. So this is the idea. And then there are some issues here. I put here a factor which should remind us that there is no Lorentz force in this picture for circular polarized fields, because in this case, the laser-induced dipole motion is aligned parallel with the B field. And this observation also highlights the sensitivity of non-dipole effects to the polarization of light. So there is a possibility, if we're interested in non-dipole effects, there's a possibility of playing around with the polarization of the light to probe various aspects of non-dipole interactions. So these are the three models, and then I want to have a look and the performance of these three models. And in this view graph to the left, I have positions in the polarization direction and in the propagation direction. And I have velocities here on the lower graph in the polarization direction and in the propagation direction. In the case of an electron in a laser field of this intensity, 3 × 10^14 watts per square centimeter, a wavelength of 3.4 microns. This corresponds to the parameters used in an experiment by the Keller group. And we have here on the x-axis, we have time in atomic units. So for these parameters, this corresponds to 10.5 cycles. Then we have different curves. We have the yellow dotted curve, which is the full retardation model. We have the blue one, which is the first order and C model. And we have the long dashed red curve, which is the one I'm particularly interested in here, which includes the effect of the B field along the trajectory induced along the polarization direction from the dipole field. All the trajectories start at the peak of the E field at the exit point, determined like this, and they move in the combined laser field and the Coulomb field after ionization. And from the figures, we clearly see that the approach with this perturbative approach, with this kind of new idea where we have this effect of the B field along the dipole induced trajectories is very good. You see it's on top of each other, also along the propagation direction here with the exact result more or less. Whereas this one here sets off, and this is due to a breakdown of this 1OC, conventional 1OC approximation when X becomes large. So this is very encouraging. So this is, we conclude here that this is an accurate classical approach. And then from this, we now go back and construct the corresponding quantum mechanical Hamiltonian. And the recipe for doing this is that is to look at the Hamiltonian, classical Hamiltonian, which reproduces those classical equations of motions. And you can verify, if you use Hamilton's classical equations, that the following Hamiltonian does just that. So here is the Hamiltonian, and it's actually the one I alluded to in the beginning, namely the one where the dominant dipole, non-dipole effect is included here in this A0.A1 term. So this is our starting point for this approach, and I call this Hamiltonian the non-dipole strong field approximation Hamiltonian, because we are led to this by including standard strong field approximation arguments. With this Hamiltonian, we have here, of course, something that depends on P, and over here, if you remember, A1 depends on X. So this is in a kind of mixed gauge, if we follow the standard wording in our field. So you can, of course, now transform X to P or P to X using the standard unitary transformations listed down here. And doing that, you can derive the non-dipole strong field approximation Hamiltonian in the velocity gauge and in the length gauge. And here you have the expressions, and the field is now no longer just A naught, but it's A naught plus a modification determined by this expression here, where you integrate up the Lorentz force. And likewise, if you want to look at it in the length gates, it's also a modified E field. It's instructive to look at this modification of the vector potential, maybe in the infinite pulse limit, where it can be solved analytically, and it's given like this here. So it's a shift in the along the propagation direction. If you have electron, the Q is negative, so it's a positive shift. It's like a radiation pressure in the propagation direction. Now, when we have the Hamiltonian, we can go through the some of the steps that we like to do, and we are always in strong field physics like to have a look at the Walker wave functions. They can be written up immediately in terms of plane wave paths, which are of course reflecting now whether you are in the velocity gates, the length gates, or the mixed gates. And you also have the phases, which are the Walker phases now with a non-dipole contribution. And in the long pulse limit, we can evaluate these phases analytically. And we see that we have the conventional kinetic energy, we have the normal UP modified a little bit. That's at least one way to get to collect the terms. So we collect terms and introduce something we call UP prime, which depends on the momentum of the ionized of the electron in the propagation direction. And we also have the cleaver motion, and we also have this typical term. So this looks pretty much like the standard Walker phase in the long pulse limit, except that we have U prime instead of U. Now, just in the end here, let me just briefly say that with this Hamiltonian, we now want to apply it. And one of the places where we can apply this and where there are open questions is in laser-assisted scattering, where there has been a problem for many years to have agreement between theory and experiment. And so you have the dipole cross-section for exchange of L photons here expressed in terms of the field-free cross-section. And you have this typical signature of the dressing field, which includes a Bessel function squared and the momentum transfer vector and the cleaver motion vector. And the non-dipole, you get more or less the same factorization, except that there is a modification of this Bessel function. It's no longer a normal Bessel function, but it's a generalized Bessel function with two arguments. And it's particularly interesting that the non-dipole contribution introduces a term here, which is proportional to the component of the momentum transfer along the propagation direction and not along the propagation direction. So when this argument is zero, this one here is in fact maximum. And therefore this will increase the laser-assisted cross-section significantly in geometries where the standard approach, including only dipole effects, would lead to vanishing cross-sections. So we are working on this for at the time being. And of course, we can also look at multiphoton ionization. I've written here the formula for multiphoton ionization in long pulse limit, including this Fourier transform of the initial orbital and a generalized Bessel function, again modified. It's not UP, but it's UP prime standing here. So we have also looked at shifts of momentum distributions in the propagation direction. In this Nature Physics paper, there was reported a shift both theoretically and experimentally in the propagation direction, which to leading order can be expressed like IP over 3C. And we find that also with this approach. And of course, this approach can also be used for laser-assisted photoelectric effect. Likewise, in streaking experiments, where of course the non-dipole shift associated with the streaking of the electron would have to be accounted for. If not, one could maybe be led to a wrong interpretation of possible time delays in such studies. So
just 1 second.
Yeah. Yeah, okay, anyway, this is the summary. And in the talk, I have given a status on the possibility of determining accurate tunneling rates for any molecule which can be treated by quantum chemistry methods by implementing an integral representation of tunneling theory. After that, I discussed some physics related to multi-electron polarization effects in strong fields and turned how a relatively simple procedure can lead to accurate model potentials for single electron dynamics in a suitable modified potential. And this, of course, is very important because it's very difficult for us to do much more than solving effective single electron models. And in the last part, I had some discussion on non-dipole effects in strong field ionization at and or strong field physics in general at low frequency. And I talked about this non-dipole strong field approximation Hamiltonian that seems to be accurate and attractive for application for linearly polarized fields. Thanks a lot for your attention.
Well, thank you so much for your nice talk. We have three questions which we're going to address. The first one is from Jens Bigert. Lars, is it conceivable with your method part two to take a core hole into account, XCV ionization rather than IR, and follow the rearrangement of the screening?
Yeah, I think this is a very interesting question that I would have liked to be able to answer. I think this is for this requires more discussion and thinking that I'm able to come up with right now.
Okay, we have a Slack channel where these questions can be posted and they can be addressed. So we have a second one. Let me see. So from Florian Opperman, how is the cutoff radius chosen for the multi-electron polarization effect?
Yeah, this is chosen on based on classical electrodynamics arguments, simply considering how this bunch of electrons are shifting in the field. So this is detailed in some of, I mean, this with the effect of polarization and turning off the effective laser electron interaction at short distances was discussed earlier on. And one of the first very nice discussions was from Thomas Barbeck and co-workers. And those references also give a detailed explanation how you can estimate this RC. And you find the references in the paper I mentioned.
And the third and final question is, could you clarify your comment about the delta function in the Lorentz force? We know that the first experimental evidence on non-dipole forward shift was measured with circular polarization. Yeah. So why is this?
Very, very good question. So the delta, so of course, in general, for the what I call the conventional approach, expansion to
okay, it's excluded here.
Okay, you can hear now what I'm saying. I try again. So if you follow the conventional approach of expanding everything to first order in C, you can treat any polarization you like. What I discuss here is an approximation to the full approach. And in that approximation, when you introduce this non-dipole strong field approximation, it turns out that there is no effect, there is no non-dipole effect for circular polarization. And this has to do with the type of the interaction, basically that the Lorentz force for circular because the fields are out of phase, basically. So it's a particular thing for this particular simplifying approximation that we have discussed here. For linearly polarized fields, it works. When you start increasing the ellipticity from linear towards circular, this approach that I call non-dipole strong field approximation approach will be gradually worse. How good it performs, of course, depends on the field strength.